Okay, welcome. This is a very exciting day for the law school because we have been able to benefit enormously from the presence of our Chief Judge, Jonathan Lippman, who has not only come to deliver a major address here tonight and then to have his address be dissected by a distinguished panel and then answer questions from the audience and the panel and everything else, but he also spent a good part of the afternoon with our students, doing a Q&A with our students, which was terrific. So we're very grateful to him for doing that. And I will introduce him in just a few minutes. Today's event is a joint venture. It takes a whole village to create a program centered around the Chief Judge of the State of New York. And I want to acknowledge all the people, or at least some of the people who are involved. So first, it's co-sponsored by two very distinguished organizations, the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy. And two people especially worked very hard on this. The editor-in-chief, Alex Cohen, who's a 3L, and the senior symposium editor, Lynn Eisenberg, also a 3L. And they put together this an evening discussing access to justice event. The other entity that played a big role in putting this together is the very distinguished Hayes program at the law school, which celebrated its 50th anniversary a couple of years ago. So you know by the time something is around that long that it's really special. And three people in particular played a big role in making this happen, in addition, of course, to actually creating the program. First, Norman Dorson, who was the founding director of the Hayes program and has run it through its whole existence, and my colleagues Sylvia Law and Helen Hirschkoff, all of whom are here tonight, and they've led change in the civil liberties front. There's no time more appropriate than now to bring together distinguished and diverse leaders in the judiciary, public service, and private practice with a common goal of figuring out how to create a better system during a time of serious financial strain. As states cut courts' budgets and reduce resources, countless Americans struggle to afford housing and health care, let alone representation that might counsel them on how to approach, for example, foreclosure proceedings or insurance claims. To compound the issue, in many places, rising law school debt affects the ability of public interest and government legal services providers to recruit and retain attorneys. And students who have a passion for public service often don't find an alternative than going into the private sector to pay off their loans. I'm pleased to say that NYU Law School, the Chief Judge's Law School, has led the way in this area and has done it for a very long time. Our Ruth Tilden Kern program, which is our flagship public service program, celebrated its 50th anniversary many years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. We had a party a number of years ago to celebrate the 25th anniversary of our loan repayment assistance program. We were the pioneers in this venture, and we now will pay essentially all of the debt service payments of any graduate who takes a public service job that makes less than a certain amount of money. And for next year, it's going to be something around $80,000. So anyone in a legitimate public service job is actually going to get their full debt service paid for. I'm very proud about this. There's only two or three law schools in the country that have taken this issue seriously. And we were the pioneers. And early in my deanship, one of the first things I did was to guarantee summer funding for all first and second year students who takes public service summer jobs. Because those jobs typically, it's not just pay little, they pay nothing at all. And the students need to support themselves for the summer, need to go to wherever this job is, rent an apartment, eat, and you know, things like that. We now guarantee this for every student. Even before the beginning of the economic crisis, we were funding about 2/3 of our first year students, and now we fund even more than that. So this is a big commitment for us. In addition, we have a terrific public interest law center that's run by Deb Ellis, class of 82, who is a champion of justice, and that's not because I say so, but because the U.S. Department of Justice said so last week when they honored Deb together with a dozen or so public interest leaders from around the country, three of whom were alums of this law school. So this is an issue that we care about a lot, and it's wonderful that that you're all here to focus on it and to see how we can make the world better. One other person who played a leading role in making all of this happen is our wonderful alumna, Helene Barnett. When Chief Judge Lippman asked Helene to head the task force to expand access to civil legal services in New York, he couldn't have picked, in my mind, a better person. I knew the chief judge had excellent judgment for a long time, but he demonstrated it again in the choice of the head of this task force. Helene, I'll introduce her formally later, but I'll just tell you sort of one little vignette. She came to talk to me when she was stepping down as the head of the Civil Division of Legal Aid, which she had sort of served in this role for a long time. And she was looking to do something in what might have been her retirement. This idea didn't last long because she quickly became the president of a legal services corporation. And for those of you who follow the politics of Washington, D.C., this is probably the politically most complex job in the federal government. And then, having done a great job at that, graduated to run the chief judge's task force. So Helene, who's also a colleague at the law school, she's a wonderful class, focusing a lot on issues that we'll talk about tonight, played a big role in planning the program and in planning the chief judge's visit. So it's now a great honor for me to introduce Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman, class of 1968. When alumni come to the law school, we always focus on this. The chief judge was 12 when he graduated from the law school. So the chief judge embodies the idea of public service. He's been a public servant in the best sense of the word during his whole career. He started out as an entry-level court attorney and law clerk in the Supreme Court and Surrogates Court. Went on to serve as principal court attorney for the Supreme Court in New York County, became deputy chief administrator for management of the statewide court system, presiding justice of the appellate division of the Supreme Court. He was also, and this is very significant, the longest serving chief administrative judge of all New York State courts in the history of New York State, a position he held from 1996 to 2007 during the chief judgeship of Judith K., class of 1962. We also mentioned this in this law school. If any of you were called to jury duty recently, you will know that this process is very different than it used to be. And you know, sometimes you worry about not thanking the right person for something good, but I can't quite tell whether all of this is because of the wonderful work of Chief Administrative Law Judge Jonathan Lippman between 1996 and 2007, or Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman from 2007 till now. But one way or the other, he has been a central player in an enormous improvement in the quality of the jury experience, in the quality of the family courts, in the quality of many other judicial institutions throughout New York State. It's hard to imagine a more important role that one can do to improve the judiciary in our state. Judge Lippman has been recognized many times for his accomplishment, including receiving the William Rehnquist Award for Judicial Excellence. And we're very proud that he, as well as his predecessor, are distinguished alumni of NYU Law School. So without further ado, I'll leave you in the great hands of the Chief Judge of the State of New York.
Thank you. I'm really honored and privileged to have been asked to speak at my alma mater, 68, as Ricky says, the New York University School of Law, which has such a long and rich history of serving the public and working for a just society. I would like to share some thoughts with you today, tonight really, about one of the most daunting challenges confronting our justice system, the crisis in civil legal aid for the poor, and what the judiciary and the profession here in New York and around the country can do to foster access to justice at a time of economic hardship for our nation and for state judiciaries. The country is dealing with serious and seemingly intractable fiscal problems, very much reflected here in our state. On April 1, New York adopted a new budget intended to close a $10 million deficit, which contains dramatic spending cuts at the state and local levels, including an unprecedented $170 million, or 6.3% reduction in the judiciary's budget request. At the same time, the economic crisis and the ongoing recession has pushed the highest number of Americans into poverty since the early 1960s, with state court dockets swelling with cases related to the economic downturn. When families can't pay their mortgages or rent, when people default on credit card payments or child support obligations, when frustrations over household finances boil over into domestic violence, it all ends up as a matter on a court docket. State courts are truly the emergency room for the ills of society, and our caseloads are proof of that fact. The kinds of cases that bring so many people into our courts, foreclosure, consumer credit, family and personal issues that flare up in times of stress, are all the more common during a downturn. Activity in our courts is countercyclical. When the economy goes south, the need for legal services rises. Yet our mission in the courts transcends these developments. We must hear and resolve each and every case that is filed with us. In the best economic times and in the worst, and maybe especially in the worst, we are constitutionally bound to deliver justice. Our doors must be open to all. Unfortunately, millions of our neighbors today desperately need the protection of our laws, but cannot afford a lawyer to help them deal with life-altering legal problems. Saving their homes from predatory lenders, recovering back wages from employers, ending abuse by a violent spouse or partner, obtaining custody of a child, and so many more. Last year alone, 2.3 million litigants appeared in the New York courts without a lawyer, including 98% of tenants in eviction cases, 99% of borrowers in hundreds of thousands of consumer credit cases, 95% of parents in child support matters, and until recently, two-thirds of homeowners facing foreclosure proceedings. According to the latest federal poverty data, statewide in New York, 2.8 million people, nearly 15% of our population, are living below the poverty level. And in New York City, that figure rises to a staggering 20.1% of residents. And those numbers do not take into account the estimated 6 million working poor in our state who live below 200% of the poverty level, or $44,700 a year for a family of four, and cannot possibly afford to hire a lawyer. It is no wonder then that providers of civil legal services to the poor in New York City are turning away 8 or 9 clients for every one that they serve. Many of our courtrooms in New York are standing room only, filled with unrepresented litigants, frightened and vulnerable people, the elderly on fixed incomes, single parents, the disabled and mentally ill, abuse victims, and so many more. And just as the need for free legal services for poor and low-income Americans is at an all-time high, the resources available to provide those services are becoming more limited than ever before. Funding for the Legal Services Corporation in Washington is under siege, and in New York, our IOLA Fund, traditionally the leading source of state funding for civil legal services, has seen its revenues plummet to a fifth of what they were just a few short years ago, from $32 million to $6.5 million. In response, we have been redoubling our efforts, both within the judiciary and in partnership with the bar, to assist the unrepresented, opening more offices of the self-represented in our high-volume courthouses, expanding volunteer lawyer for a day programs that provide lawyers for poor litigants when they enter our New York City courthouses, and expanding pro bono programs throughout the state. All of these creative efforts are helpful in easing the access to justice problem, but they do not come anywhere close to solving the problem. The needs are simply too overwhelming. I have become convinced that the totality of what we are doing in New York, and as far as I can see around the country, is simply not enough. It is simply not enough to rely on the wonderful good works of the bar and on a patchwork of unreliable revenue streams that constantly fluctuate with the ups and downs of the economy and the political winds of the day. What is needed, I believe, is the unequivocal commitment of state government to fund civil legal services, a commitment backed by the public fisc. And while I recognize that this is a very tall order in these difficult economic times, like going directly into the teeth of a hurricane, the bottom line is that access to justice is one of the most fundamental obligations we owe our citizenry, and it must be treated as such. I have also come to the belief that the judiciary as an institution must take a strong and visible leadership role on this issue, because we cannot properly carry out our constitutional mission of providing equal justice under the law when millions of people are appearing in court without a lawyer to guide them through adversarial proceedings that involve the very necessities of life. As judges and lawyers, we are all witnesses to how the lack of civil legal aid can unbalance the scales of justice and prove devastating to the lives of our fellow citizens and their families. We cannot stand by passively and consider litigants faceless numbers on crowded court dockets without regard to whether they are represented, without regard to whether they are able to protect their rights, and without regard to whether justice is really and truly being done. We cannot stand by when equal justice is so seriously at risk. In New York, the thrust of our efforts has been to develop a systemic approach to this critical problem. I am convinced that without the infrastructure, the plumbing, if you will, to ensure a stable, consistent, ongoing funding for civil legal services, now and for the future, legal service providers will in large numbers literally have to shut their doors. To systematically achieve what needed to be accomplished in New York, I began on Law Day 2010, by forming the task force to expand access to civil legal services in New York, chaired by former president of the Federal Legal Services Corporation, Helene Barnett, to whom I am so grateful for agreeing to take on this incredibly challenging assignment of leading the task force consisting of judges, lawyers, business executives, and labor leaders from all parts of the state. Last fall, with the task force's assistance, I personally presided over four public hearings around the state to assess the extent and nature of the unmet civil legal needs. I was joined at each hearing by Helene, individual members of the task force, and the highest level of leadership of the state judiciary and the State Bar Association. We all recognized that if the judiciary and the legal profession did not stand up for civil legal services for the poor in a time of crisis, no one else would. If not us, who? We were able to get the State Senate and Assembly to adopt a joint resolution endorsing these hearings and requesting that the Chief Judge report and make recommendations annually to the governor and the legislature on the findings of the hearings, the work of the task force, and the need for additional resources. What we learned from last year's hearings is that New York is at best meeting only 20% of the civil legal services needs of its low-income residents. The task force recommended, and I adopted the recommendation, that the judiciary include $25 million for civil legal services in its budget for the 2011-2012 fiscal year as part of a four-year phased-in effort to increase annual funding by $100 million. In New York, treating funding for civil legal services, including legal assistance that helps keep cases out of court, as part and parcel of the judiciary budget makes total sense to me. The message it sends is simple. As far as the judiciary is concerned, ensuring access to justice goes to the very heart of our constitutional mission. Just as important as keeping our courthouse doors open is the substance of what is actually happening behind those doors. Justice, to be meaningful, must be accessible to all, both poor and rich. If we don't have that, we might as well shut the courthouse doors. Increasing court funding without ensuring access to justice would be a hollow victory. State courts in New York and elsewhere must have the resources they need, not just as an end in itself, but to support their constitutional and ethical role as the protector of the legal rights of all Americans, regardless of means. Despite the deep cuts imposed on the judiciary, our final budget approved by the governor and the legislature included $12.5 million in new funding for civil legal services, which was distributed to 56 nonprofit legal services organizations, and a $15 million appropriation to the judiciary to rescue IOLA, with the end result being $27.5 million of state funding for civil legal services under the umbrella of the judiciary budget. This is an accomplishment that the legal community in New York is proud of, particularly given the economic tsunami that we in New York and around the country recognize as today's reality. To me, most importantly, we established a vital precedent and template for our state and possibly elsewhere by implementing a systemic annual process to fund civil legal services through state monies that are an integral part of the judiciary's overall budget. At the legislature's request, we hold hearings to assess the gap in civil legal representation for the poor. We recommend the amounts needed by the judiciary to close or at least narrow that gap, and the legislature and the governor act on our request. And that is the process we have again undertaken this year, already holding hearings in New York City, White Plains, Albany, and Buffalo. It is my firm belief that reliance on revenue streams like IOLA or court fees that fluctuate with the economy while sometimes necessary and justifiable on a pragmatic level, is not in the end the answer. Access to justice cannot be a pay-as-you-go enterprise dependent on funding that is unstable by nature and that, while intended to make the justice system more available with one hand, often erects new obstacles to access, like higher filing fees, with the other. Civil legal assistance for poor and vulnerable litigants should come out of state general fund monies. It is a basic responsibility of state government, every bit as important as other fundamental priorities of a civilized society. We don't say that we're eliminating public schools or hospitals or courts this year to serve our children or treat our sick or deliver justice because the economy is bad. Just as we cannot say that we won't fund civil legal services for the indigent because it is too difficult to afford. Access to justice is not a luxury, affordable only in good times. It is a bedrock principle in a society based on the rule of law and transcends the vagaries of our economy. Beyond the compelling legal and moral justifications, assuring civil legal assistance for the poor and the working poor makes sense on so many other levels. What too many people fail to recognize is that expanding civil legal representation at public expense actually pays for itself many times over. At last year and this year's hearings, business leaders, bankers, property owners, healthcare providers, and government and community leaders testified that increasing access to legal assistance benefits, their institutional performance and financial bottom lines. We heard again and again that civil legal services save our state and local governments hundreds of millions of dollars a year by enabling people to pay their bills, preventing unwarranted evictions and homelessness, avoiding foster care placements and other social services costs, and bringing federal funds into the state. We developed a public record that justified the funding of civil legal services as making good economic sense for our state. Our task force concluded that New York receives a total return of close to $5 for every dollar spent to support civil legal assistance for the poor. What we are doing is focusing first and foremost on providing counsel for those people who come to our courthouses seeking the essentials of life: a roof over their heads, family stability, personal safety free from domestic violence, access to health care and education or subsistence income and benefits, as well as legal assistance that can help resolve these issues without even having to come to court. That is the best way we can make immediate and meaningful progress to help the most vulnerable among the poor and working poor. Money for civil legal services is surely the major part of the equation, but we also critically need a comprehensive, multifaceted approach that involves the entire legal community working together to foster more self-help programs for the unrepresented and more pro bono programs from law schools, bar associations, law firms, and the courts, such as the court system's Attorney Emeritus Program, which targets an underutilized pro bono resource: retired and senior lawyers, including the baby boomers, who are nearing retirement age and want to continue having a meaningful role in the legal world. We are all responsible for doing the hard and necessary groundwork to make sure that equal justice is a reality and not just an ideal. Litigants in civil proceedings should receive representation in keeping with the ethos of the Supreme Court's decision almost 50 years ago in the landmark case of Gideon versus Wainwright, a case that was not just about the constitutional right to counsel for criminal defendants, but a clarion call to recognize our societal obligation to give legal assistance to human beings facing life-transforming crises in our courts. Clarence Earl Gideon's trumpet, forever memorialized in Tony Lewis's Pulitzer Prize-winning book, sounds for all those whose basic human needs are at stake in a legal system that must be meaningful for each and every one of us, whether in criminal or civil cases, and regardless of means. Make no mistake, the issues at stake in civil cases involving the necessities of life can be every bit as critical to one's existence and well-being as the very loss of liberty itself. And I am not suggesting that each and every person with a legal problem should have legal representation at the public's expense. There is no way our government could possibly provide a lawyer to every poor person in every civil matter. Instead, we need a measured, common sense approach that recognizes our obligations to the less fortunate among us, while at the same time prioritizing our resources, particularly in light of today's fiscal realities. We are seeing more and more experiments on the ground with new ideas and approaches designed to increase funding for counsel in civil matters, to increase lawyer volunteerism, and to otherwise expand the availability of counsel in civil cases involving the necessities of life. It is being manifested today in pilot projects in California, Philadelphia, Boston, and elsewhere across the country, and in the template that I have talked about tonight that we have developed in New York for the systemic public funding of civil legal services. The growing momentum is supported by the endorsement of influential national organizations like the Conference of Chief Justices and the American Bar Association, which adopted resolutions in support of, respectively, leadership by chief judges in expanding funding for civil legal assistance and the establishment of government-provided legal counsel as a matter of right at public expense to low-income persons where basic human needs are at stake. We are incrementally creating a climate that may one day enable courts of law to affirm what the court of public opinion will have already recognized, that equal justice and fundamental fairness requires public funding of legal counsel in civil cases involving basic human needs. Each time a state or local legislature or a bar association or a law school expands the availability of counsel in its own domain, we come one step closer to this goal. Each time another task force or study shows the positive benefits to litigants and society of providing counsel, and each year that we obtain significant funding in the judiciary budget for civil legal services in New York, we come one step closer to making the scales of justice evenly balanced for all. Without question, all of these efforts are part of a larger, ongoing process to foster a social understanding that fundamental fairness is not possible in our courts unless there are lawyers to help people with civil matters implicating fundamental human needs. At the hearings we have conducted in New York, we have heard from the poor, the working poor, educated and uneducated alike, immigrants, members of a wide range of racial and ethnic groups, young mothers, and the elderly, about how free civil legal services salvaged their lives and prevented them from falling off the societal cliff and through the cracks of the safety net, and allowing them and their families to be contributing members of society and their local community. The public hearings also allowed us to assemble a diverse coalition representing a consensus in support of public funding of civil counsel. It sends a powerful message when such a broad and diverse group manages to join together across very different political and ideological perspectives to speak out in support of civil legal services for the poor. We must combine the human stories with the empirical data that can inform policymakers and provide a strong factual basis for change. It is absolutely critical that we quantify through statistically reliable studies the cost savings to our government and society derived from the provision of counsel. We can and must create a record that justifies the public funding of civil legal services as a good investment that makes economic sense for our country and states. The alleged unaffordability of public funding of civil legal services has long proven to be one of the most insurmountable obstacles in this area. It is a fallacy. We cannot afford not to fund civil legal services for the well-being and stability of our society and our institutions, for the ethical underpinnings of our democratic way of life, for the financial bottom line of our state and local governments, and for our constitutional and professional duty to foster equal justice for all, which is for us, as judges and lawyers, our very reason for being. All of us, not only judges, lawyers, and law professors, but also lawmakers and people who care about equal justice in this state and country, can change the dialogue and ultimately the legal landscape of America when it comes to civil legal representation. The rule of law, which is the bedrock of our profession and our society, loses its meaning when the protection of our laws is available only to those who can afford it. Any civilized society, going back to biblical times, is judged by how it treats its most vulnerable citizens. And the admonition of the Old Testament, "Justice, justice shall you pursue, for rich and poor, high and low alike," is just as relevant today as it was thousands of years ago. The pursuit of justice is what our noble profession is all about. And pursuing justice is what we must do if we are to maintain the ethical core and the very legitimacy of our system of justice. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.